right, this is John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. So we have another exciting episode for you. In this episode, I know a lot of you guys have been waiting for this. We're going to do a TD update, but it's even going to be better than a TD update because it's going to be a TD who I filmed for the last 2 years. I have episodes on his whole growing process from the time he starts his seeds to harvest and how he does it all. Links down below to all those videos. I think there's like over a dozen videos that I've shown you his whole process, what he is still duplicating and maybe even improving just a little bit today. And then, as you guys know, for this season, I've been filming Super Seth's garden and showing what he's growing there. So literally this episode, we're gonna have a head-to-head TD versus Seth. Who grows it better? Maybe not say who grows it better, but how they grow it differently and what, you know, gets them to grow the cannabis and their growing methods, comparing one against the other so that you guys may be able to learn some techniques from each of the guys who know all their own stuff, right, that grow great stuff, and you guys could use the best techniques of all of them and find out what works for you. Maybe you're going to do what TD does for this, but you like what Seth does for this, and then you're going to find your own method and maybe one of you guys will beat what they're doing here. So anyways, let's go ahead and get into this video and show you guys a TD update. We're currently here, almost August. It's the end of July, and I'll show you guys TD's girls that he's got planted back here. And honestly, guys, these girls are more giant than any year that I've been here before. They're about a month ahead, right? End of July, look how tall these girls are. They're insane. They're like over 6 feet tall. I'm not measuring the width, man, but these things are quite wide, and this is just one plant. I don't even want to call it a plant. It's actually a tree, but this is what you're going to learn if you guys watch the previous TD episodes. Once again, links down below. I'm not going to go over his whole method to his madness because it would take hours and hours. But what I will share with you guys this episode is what he is doing new and different for this year, as well as share the varieties, the cultivars he's growing, the genetics he's growing this year. All right, so this first girl is a blueberry cupcake hybrid, and it's about 60 days, and you can see it's well far along, doing quite well. And here's the thing, the first three plants I'm gonna show you guys, he's done something special, and these three are a lot larger than the other three. What he's been doing for this year only, right, is new, all his trim. So when he's done harvesting and curing and he trims all his plants to get the buds, he has all the scrap, including popcorn buds and all the trim stuff. He basically took a whole barrel of this and dumped it in each of his in-ground pots. Once again, link down below to how I helped him build this very in-ground pot. So all his trim got dumped in and was composted over the off season in the winter time. Also, some of these he had to actually dig out because he had to replace the plastic lining in there. But the other thing I noticed is that he's doing new this year is that this year he also has the yellow sticky all the way around the bottom, right, to prevent the bugs, the earwigs. He has major issues with earwigs sometimes going in there. So he has this sticky stuff going all around the whole bottom of the grow. Now, the other thing he's doing really cool this year that I've never heard anybody do in cannabis is he is dry farming his cannabis. It rained so much here last year that he had a soil engineer guy come out and check out the soil. And he basically planted his girls and he doesn't water them at all. He hasn't watered at all, like nothing, which is crazy. So we have a moisture meter here. We can stick it into the ground and you can see it's on the maximum moisture. So that's insane. So like, you know, the ground is literally a water storage. I mean, right? And because his pots are built in, it has plastic lining, it stored all the water in there. So he's not having to waste any water. So this is like, you know, water saving cannabis cultivation, the techniques that TD's doing. And because he's, you know, not watering his plants, he's hoping that his plants are gonna be a lot stronger. Like if you ever do dry farm tomatoes, they have a lot more flavors than the ones that are being watered, right? So maybe his cannabis would be the best year ever growing the cannabis dry farm. So of course, one of TD's favorite genetics to grow is the vanilla cream pie. This girl is popping out of the cage. Look how healthy this girl looks. Nice, deep, rich green leaves. Now the cool thing is, right, TD doesn't super trim his plants, right? He wants a lot of leaf material because every leaf material, all the leaves here, are solar panels, right? You could have more solar panels in your house, create more energy, and when the plant has a lot of leaves on there, It's going to create more sugars, send down to the roots, feed the root zone, you know, get the plant a lot stronger, have it grow a lot better. So when it is ready to flower, it's going to produce a lot more flowers. Of course, we have all the videos on how he trains his plants as well. Links down below. So this is TD's biggest plant. This is called the lemongrass. It's an indica. It's like a 50-day plant. Once again, this girl is popping out as well, looking real nice. And then so these are the first three that are like just super giant, super huge, popping out. And I'm gonna show you guys this next. So look at this, man. TD's got gophers, right? Number one thing is that his girls are being all grown in cages. So once again, link down below how he built a in-ground pot that he basically lined with the fabric cloth so that the gophers can't get to his cannabis roots. So he don't care that they're here, but of course he's gonna get them. But why I wanted to show you guys this is because a gopher just dug up this hole this morning, and look at this. You can see the top of the hole is dry, right? If we dig down right here, right here, I can dig in a little bit and it's nice and moist, right? This is why he does not have to water, because literally this whole ground here is like literally soaked with water as a reservoir because it did rain so much last year. All right, next plant up is a blueberry muffin. And this girl's kind of getting droopy. I know he had some challenges on some of these plants with some earwigs, but we're not sure why it's droopy, only in some areas, right? If you guys are trying to do dry farming and your plant is drooping everywhere, then that might be a watering issue, but because it's only drooping a few random leaves, he's not really sure, so he's gonna continue to monitor and check this plant to see what's up, because most of the plant looks amazing. So one of the reasons why this stuff might be happening is because the birds have been loving this cannabis plant. They've been making nests in here and going in and out, so they may be messing something up. All right, next plant up is the hella jelly. And you're thinking, John, that one looks pretty small. Yes, you're right. This is a 70% sativa plant, so it's a little bit smaller, not as big as the indicas that you guys just saw. But once again, I guess these plants now, he didn't put all the trim waste, and I'm sure in upcoming years, he's gonna start putting all the trim waste and some of his plants, because you know they grow a lot better when he's done that, because you're giving the plant all the nutrients it absorbs into the leaves to compact down to not only, you know, give nutrients for the plant for the following season, but also create the right microbes that love those nutrients and will then feed your plant the following season. All right, last plant is the apple blossom. This girl is also looking really good. And once again, I really like how he's doing this on the bottom here. We're gonna have to ask him what kind of like material this is that basically has a sticky, it's almost like a sticky tape all the way around. I've been having some ants in my personal garden, my vegetable garden, so this might be helpful for me too. But I love that he's doing it instead of like the stupid like little things that he also has in random spaces as well. So that's the mini tour. If you guys want to learn more about how TD grows all these, once again, links down below. I'm not going to recreate the whole series I did for 2 years here at TD's, because his methods didn't change except for the two things he's doing this year new. Is he put the tote for the top first three plants. He's dry farming. And then the last thing is, while he is not watering his plants, he is foliar feeding like he has in previous years. And he's been doing the Boogie Brew compost tea every week. I think he just stopped doing it. You know, because we're getting into August now. All right, so if you guys want to learn more about how TD is growing this season and get more updates on all everything growing on here, right? Don't check my channel, because I have last year's and the year before for TD, but the Boogie Brew channel, link down below. Boogie Brew out on YouTube, right? They've been filming TD's garden, so you guys can see all the latest updates and how everything is growing here. So make sure you check out the Boogie Brew channel. That's Josh, of course. All right, so up next, let's go ahead and head over to Super Seth's garden and show you guys his cannabis plants to see if they're larger than TD's or not. All right, so next up, I want to show you guys actually how Super Seth's garden is growing this year and all his cannabis plants. He's doing it a lot different than TD. You know, TD basically, as you guys saw, has it all mulched out really thick. He dug in-ground pots to grow, and as you guys saw, it's doing amazing. You know, Seth has a little bit different technique. He has one in a fabric pot. He also is growing in standard raised beds, and he has a few also plants in the ground. And just looking at these, the plants in the ground actually are appearing to do the best. So you might want to plant the plants actually in the ground. So we're going to go around to all his girls and show the guys what he's growing and how big they are. So this is a red hot cookies. And as you guys can see, for some reason, this girl is prematurely flowering. Hopefully it'll end up doing pretty good. At the end, we're not exactly sure why, it just might be a short season variety cultivar. This is a purple ghost candy. And as you guys can see, he's been actually trimming a lot more leaves than TD does. So, you know, once again, I mean, it's a balance. You can't have too many leaves. You still want airflow, but you don't want to have too few leaves. In my opinion, I mean, I think Seth might be harvesting or trimming too many leaves off. This one's called Full Gas. Definitely doing really nice. And you can see his bending and crimping technique that we showed two episodes ago is doing good, but it is definitely not superior than how TD does it. And then in the middle here, he's got some peyote Skittles. And I think actually these are a higher CBD variety with the THC, which is something that I'm more in favor of. And I think, you know, just focusing on high THC varieties is not the way. The cannabis plant is full of different phytonutrients, including different terpenoids and cannabinoids. And we should focus on getting the widest spectrum and diversity to them for the greatest health benefit, besides just that intoxicating effect that many people like. This plant here is really cool. This is the Thai wild cannabis. And this one says does not like to be trained at all. It just wants to do its own thing. So it's really like tall and lanky. This one's the Runtz Times layer cake. You guys can see this got some nice girth to the bottom there. Not quite catching up the TD's girth there on his. Also a lot taller. Looks like, you know, he's really letting this get a little bit too tall instead of more wide. So, I mean, if it was me, I'd try to pull it more wide or even just pull it down all the way and let new shoots grow up. All right, so the last two plants we're going to go over here real quick. This is the Full Gas, and this is the Full Gas in the ground that he's been basically mulching with the leaves themselves. You know, I encourage you guys to eat the leaves or juice them up. But, yeah, this is how this is going. But, so these are pretty much planted at the same time as TD's. But they're definitely a lot smaller. So what do you guys think so far in this episode? Did you guys think that like Seth has a better growing technique than TD? Well, to me, it's clear. I mean, I appreciate what Seth is growing and some of the genetics he's using, as well as some of the techniques that you've learned in previous episodes. This is the Korean natural farming and a lot of things he does to build soil. The other thing that I'll mention is that, you know, this is a relatively newer grow. So Seth is still working on his soil, not quite as refined as TD. Of course, TD's definitely got a few years on Seth as well, so a bit more maturity and experience growing as well. I think the last thing I want to do in this episode is we're going to sit down with TD, Super Seth, and Josh and ask them some questions about the cannabis grows and what you can learn and how they're growing similar and how some of their philosophies are similar, but also more importantly, how they're different. All right, so we're here with TD, Super Seth, and Josh, of course, and you guys just saw both gardens. What do you guys think? I want to hear your comments down below. In any case, right, I have my own opinions about that, but what I want to go over with you guys now is talk about the different techniques that TD and Seth uses and get some of the feedback from Josh on this as well, so that you guys could learn maybe techniques from TD, some techniques from Seth, and what motivates these guys to just grow the cannabis like they do. So I want to ask first TD and Seth, why do you guys grow cannabis?
TD, I grow mine for free smoke and so I could enjoy growing plants. I just get off on getting them as big as I can. It's amazing to me. And like for the first time when I talked to Josh this year, he's like, dude, I gotta get over there. You sound so excited. I'm like, I gotta come see this. But the dry farming is phenomenal. And so that's really got me juiced up this year.
Wait, yeah, and then my answer to that question is pretty similar. I'd say the free smoke is unbeatable, and then exactly. I know it did, and so like a lot of people will be like at a club, and they'll like, you know, there's all these different cannabis brands, but like really, it's a lot of the same genetics grown with the same nutrients and stuff. And so, you know, when you grow like TD does, or you grow like I do, you know, everything that goes into it, and you know, gardening is. It's really fun, it's cheaper than therapy, and you end up with produce at the end. So that's why I garden, and then the cannabis is kind of just along for the ride with the rest of the gardening hobby, for sure.
And you end up with a terpene festival
exactly,
to boot, you know?
Yeah.
And I mean, speaking of terpene festivals, not to cut in, but John, I happen to be the privileged recipient of some TD me down you know, somewhat age at 2020, like,
yeah, incredible. 2 years old.
Yeah.
3 years old.
Incredible bulk. And the GG number four. Now tell John's audience what happened when you shared it with the dude that John's already interviewed, yeah, who runs the aquaponics system down.
Yeah, so every time I bring the Gorilla Glue number four from TD.
2 years old.
Yeah, so some two-year-old nuggets,
yeah,
of
aged
cannabis.
GG4 from TD. Let's
this
get
stuff,
that aged factor in
this
there.
Stuff puts people on their ass. Yep. They smoke it, and then they're like, dude, did you put hash in there or something? What is going on with this? And it's nothing. It's just straight
TD's buds. Aged
buds. It's just the good stuff, man. That GG4 smokes like hash because it's so incredibly strong.
That product
is so thick and potent.
Anesia seeds.
Ah, all right.
Good to know.
So money's like manure. Spread it around, right? Not just with Humboldt seeds. Yeah. Although he's so loyal to Humboldt seed.
I am
I really love Humboldt seeds. They've done nothing but tell the truth. Like I told you, I've bought in seeds from other companies that they're bullshit when you get them here. They're piney tasting and all that crap. And it's just supposed to be fruity. There's no way that fruit and pine are the same taste. You know what I mean?
Right.
And it's not that I pumped them full of all this crap or anything. It's the same OA.
And Humboldt seed also sort of caters in, well, from what I can tell, Humboldt seed seems to cater more towards people that are interested in growing in living soil, mm-hmm, interested in things like maximizing plant terpenes and stuff like that.
They were the only company that showed up to the SLS.
Yeah.
You know, tell the audience, we got this SLS series. Got to get you the rest of the footage with you and me, like talking about, what was it? What's the top, what is the
top tips?
It? Yeah, John, what was it?
I forget now.
No, come on, for the soil. What, you asked me to go to there, to the Soil Life Summit, and ask everyone one key question. What was that? What is
the
your
best top tip to grow the best buds?
And I already guessed, long before you and I ever did the part that I have to give you, Seth, to add to that, you know, everyone's response, the short video you're going to have on your channel, and of course, this was fungi, because this is a fungi.
There you go.
Forgot about that footage.
I forgot
all
about
right.
that already.
So
that
we got so a cool. bunch more questions for these guys here today, so... You know, I know that you both you guys use organic gardening growing methods. So tell the audience why you don't use the hydroponic nutrients and why they shouldn't either.
Deadrians, John.
Deadrians.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, right off the bat, if you're going to use deadrians, the way you guys call them, you're going to burn your plants. I can guarantee it. Because no one's going to be able to, like, when they get this size, how much more do you give them? Mm-hmm. So it's a guessing game with that crap. My stuff all breaks down slow release, and I don't even have to feed. I don't have to go and do that. Everybody else is feeding throughout the year. I haven't fed them one time, but the Boogie Brew tea's all been doing fuller feeding.
And you don't want to use, I offered him some top dressing, you know, what we mm-hmm. could afford to sponsor him with. He's like, don't need it, Josh.
Incredible. I think we're good.
Yeah, I think you are too, man. Yeah.
They got everything they need and nothing they don't.
They're doing really, really well. So I'd rather just... Deadrians to me, I did use them when I first started. The first 3 or 4 years, I used Fishy Motion and stuff like that.
That's not deadrians.
It's still hot though.
Okay, so there's different levels of deadrians, John.
I don't consider Fishy Motion deadrians.
Yeah, okay, yeah. But still, you can burn your plants with the heartbeat.
But not kill your soil. So right. The term deadrian is you're making your soil life dead, right? And you were supposed to answer this question too before I keep cutting in.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. I mean, my answer is. I don't want to have to measure anything. I don't want to have to mess around with a chemical company. I don't want to worry, you know, like, God forbid my dog would get into some of my fertilizer. All my fertilizer is, you know, it's whatever. It's just a bunch of whatever fish crap or whatever it all is. They'd be fine. The other reason is just, like, there is nothing like organic food. Like, it's so different. Like, if you A/B test it and, you know, I don't know if I've ever, like, literally A/B tested, but if you were to, everyone that grows it knows it. It's like the living soil is the good shit. It's the best tasting cannabis. It's the easiest way to grow it. People tie themselves in a knot, mixing chemicals and balancing pH and all this other mess. Just
that's
like you got burnt, man.
Oh,
like,
we all did. I mean, we've all been down that path. We've all tried
that's
to, we've
thing.
Had
really
that more is more consciousness. We've had, you know, we've had gals behind the counter of a hydro store make us feel proud of dropping $1,000 on deadrians. I'm guilty of that. I learned the hard way.
I'm saying that when you use those deadrians too, like you said, you have to really watch your pH levels.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be a control freak.
I've never measured my pH in my garden because I don't need to.
Exactly.
Yeah.
When was the last time you measured your pH in your vegetable gardens?
I never measured my pH at all.
Never, not in living memory.
No, yeah. I don't even measure it. I mean, nature's self-balancing, that's an amazing thing, like, right? You get a good system, you use good nutrients, and the bacteria figures it all out.
Real nutrients, life-giving. Yeah. Don't you think the term nutrient is a lie? Is another chemotoxicity lie?
All right, so next I want to ask TD and Seth, what's your philosophy about growing? Like, what's your overall philosophy?
What do you mean?
It's his life.
I do it just because I love it.
Like philosophy, like what techniques do you use to grow? I mean, obviously philosophy is organic, but then beyond organic, do you do like the bare minimum to your soil so you can be the most hands-off, or do you like to like, you know?
Actually, I put all my nutrients in the soil as we went over with Josh this year. He watched me mend it. And
I mend
the soil then, and that's all I do.
You amend it once. So your philosophy is amend it once and then let the stuff grow. And then maybe do compost tea, you know, once a week.
Every Sunday.
Not to interrupt again, but he almost resisted Leah's and my urges to take some. We had just bought a bunch of vegan mix and neem seed meal, and I was hysterical about all the rain. And I was like, dude, you at least need some neem seed meal in there, because God forbid root rot come. Because going back to my experience with deadrians, root rot got me. Like, karma beat.
Oh, yeah.
Karma was a bitch and got me, like, within my second grow. That's why I switched from hydro 30 effing years ago. But it's way more forgiving. But he had this issue where everything was a swamp. And I was worried. I was like, what was I telling you to go buy at Harmony Farm Supply?
Biochar and neem oil.
You have your lazari. He had all his lazari here ready to absorb. No, the root rot fighting mycostop.
Yeah.
Mycostop, which is like last ditch, you know, Ukraine war effort, you know, like if you've got it already, if it's present, like don't even F with it. Get that biofungicide, the one Harmony sells, mycostop. If you soil and you were like, nah, it still smells okay, Josh. It'll be all right. You were like, less is more already, but I was really worried about that.
Yeah. So then, John, my answer to your question is, my philosophy is low and slow, listen to the plants, happy worms, happy soil, happy plants. You know, it's like all of this stuff is interconnected, and you really see it when you, when you live it in your garden.
I love how you harvested your low and slow.
Yeah,
We have an episode with Grizz, Grizzly. Yeah. The hemp t-shirt guy, and when I asked him the top tip, and it'll be in the video your audience can see on your channel, the top tips from all these gurus, and this guy had gone down the hydro path too, right?
Totally, yeah.
And he's like, low and slow.
Low and slow is the way to
go. All right, next question, guys, is seeds or clones?
Seeds,
big time. So in the first episode I did with you, you showed my clone room, or my mother room, where I was taking clones from, and those clones did just okay. You know, like, I find that the clone doesn't quite have the vigor of the seed, and it also has a different feel. Like, when you run the plant in your hands, the plant is, like, more brittle, and it just feels like, I mean, it's just like an incomplete plant, you know? A full plant is from seed to harvest.
Full term.
It's one thing. Mm-hmm. And then when you start cloning stuff, it's like, is that clone going to be any better? Like, is there any chance that clone will be better than a seed? I don't think so.
Seeds are stronger.
Yeah, seeds all the way. And it's easier. Yeah, just get feminized seeds if you're new.
Taproot
is huge. Yeah.
There's where it is. You want a taproot or you don't? You want a spine or you want to just be vulnerable?
I've grown some big clones too.
Yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
Clones can do great. And for some people, they're easier. Like if you just go to the club, they've got a rack of clones. You just buy a few of those.
But
that's
unless
fine.
You get the first harvest of a clone off a plant, a mother plant, you won't get the double shoots on each side. They're going to be staggered. They're going to work their way around the branch. So,
But, I mean, TD, what would you...
Like right now, if we went and pulled one of the branches that are hanging out outside that, I guarantee you they're already staggered. Mm-hmm. They're going around the plant.
Structurally, it violates your contractor's level. Like, you wouldn't run build a building that way.
Yeah.
You would. You're dealing with a weaker structure to begin
like
with.
Seeds. Yeah, and they say that regular seeds are even stronger than feminized. So, you know, it's what people say.
Well, let me ask you this, not to interrupt his line of questions, but what would you prefer, seed autoflower or bitching clones?
Bitching clones. Really?
Seed autoflower. I'll back him up on that. I'm going to back him up. Yeah, because I sampled your blueberry muffs.
Yeah, that wasn't supposed to be
that. That blueberry muffs, that little, did you get any of that?
No.
Oh, you should have, dude, that blueberry
muff. First thing he said, and it's really funny too.
It's an odd flower percent.
Yeah, yeah. They say it's like you're in a bakery shop. Yeah. And he's like, dude, it's like I'm in a pastry shop. I'm like, that's exactly what they say.
This was back in June, and he had a. She wasn't a volunteer. You knew she was going to yield around that time.
Yeah. What happened?
Was she a bonus?
She was an auto flower.
Those were the bonus you or something.
I planted too early. Remember?
So even auto flowers, you can plant them too early.
No, that wasn't an auto flower.
Oh, it should have been or could have been.
Yeah.
Do they have a blueberry muff autoflower?
Yes, they do.
HSC has about half their catalog is autoflowers and maybe slightly more than half their catalog.
Well, the strength of that, so you could argue that that was nowhere near what we're going to get the privilege of enjoying.
Bro.
And that was water.
I thought she was autoflower. I swear I thought she was autoflower. She was AF. I wonder what would have been stronger, AF that yielded then or this premature thing that you started too early?
I know we should have kept the flower, huh?
Yeah. Next year.
Bogarts.
Well, you love AFs, right?
No, not anymore. I thought I loved autoflowers, and I think next year I'm just going to do 6 photo periods of, like, my favorite genetics.
And what is your beef with AFs?
I don't really like the structure, the way they grow. It's just, I don't know. It's just not a photo period
plant. It's not enough plant.
I just want like a
They're
straightforward
made for
plan.
People that are in business to sell.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not selling, so.
Exactly.
You do it for a sport. Why would you mess with amateur level
gear? I'm never going to
You're
get,
pro all the
I
way.
I would never
we're,
even get
We're
those
pros
precise.
With the pros right here, all of us.
Yeah.
We know we all know who's the pros and the bros here. I'm definitely the boogie bro. I'm sitting amongst some pros. But let's get back to letting John ask some key questions.
All right, next question for the two guys are how do you train your plants? I mean, they have vastly different training techniques. So, TD.
I start off with a small cage, and I try to take everybody out at about a 55-degree angle to 60-degree angle, and then once they get out, then I start to pull them over that cage, and that's how I get my shoots to start. And then from there on, I just let them do their own thing with the shoots-wise. I don't pinch or anything like that. I'm not a pincher.
I'm basically the opposite. I pretty much just super crop and pinch all my plants, and so far this year, I have not needed to use a trellis net, but I think for some of my plants that are like a little larger that might have heavier collared buds, this year I'm going to be putting them up in a trellis and just fasten the trellis to like nearby things. Sort of the way TD does it here, he fastens his trellis to the cage on the outside of the plants. I'll probably just fasten my trellis to like things in my garden so that I can keep the plants from like falling over and stuff
Stakes
like that.
And stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, next question is how do you guys feed your plants during the season?
I don't.
Maybe a bit of boogie brew for TD.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
Foliar feed.
You're feeding soil, right?
Foliar feed the tea. I spray the rest on the bottom like I showed you, but yeah. We don't...
barely.
Not even really watering to feed either, you know what I mean? There's no real good action going on this year at all. Period.
Yeah, we filmed a good episode about that.
Totally. Yeah. And the way I feed my plants is, like an occasional diluted compost tea. Maybe some fermented plant juice, and then I also use things like, you know, like a flowering top dress of some kind. And we're gonna go make that happen at my house after this. We're gonna show everyone how I sort of like, you know, get all these various things together, mix them up, and then use it as a top dress.
So if you could only give one tip to, you know, share with my viewers, your best tip to get the maximum production, what would it be, TD and Seth?
Pull them down and open them up. That's what I'd say. Pull them down and open them up. More shoots, more flower.
Yeah. Yeah, to train them out sideways, like TD's saying, is a great tip. If you're talking about maximizing production, is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
I mean, it depends on your soil, but you probably want to run some nitrogen early in the year and then phosphorus and potassium later in the year. That's how I would think you'd get the most buds. Like, if you're talking about just, like, chemically, that's like what I would think.
Well, chemically versus more organically, and just letting the plant do what they're thinking.
I'm saying on a chemistry level, not like not using detrients, but like you know, you're gonna need nitrogen somehow, some way at the beginning of the season, and then in order to bulk up those buds, you'll need phosphorus and potassium and calcium the whole way through too. By the way,
but he had it stored already.
No,
even
yeah.
Without a cover crop.
Exactly.
That's the thing is
he had it in the hole, and then this goes back to I was gonna ask John, like, how do you grow? Less is more. If out of these two, who is really doing less and getting more?
Obviously, TD.
I don't know. You haven't hung out and worked in Jones' place.
Oh, between
I do way less.
You do way less than anyone I know, bro.
I thought you were talking about
I throw some stuff on. I don't even do compost this year.
I mean, you guys.
I barely foliar feed because I've been so lazy.
Well, I mean, even at your place, like out of those magnificent boxes.
Yeah, I don't really. I just the water comes on, and I plant stuff, and they grow, and I don't really.
Whatever
do
compost
that.
You can grab.
Throw some
Boogie
compost
Brew.
On the top, and that's it.
So to put a cap on that, if you are a soil master like TD is, then maybe you don't need to add a bunch of nitrogen, or you don't need to add phosphorus and potassium.
Or is that getting in your way, man? Is that getting in your way and impeding your process because you're trying to play God too much,
yeah.
like you would with nutrients,
yeah.
versus letting let the soil in the forest to fertilize the forest once you have it set up properly.
But exactly. Seth practices that in a living, but he's still got, look who has a picnic bench with more cornucopia of products on
Seth has more, but what is his garden show?
And didn't I say in one of the videos we did with TD that the mark of a true pedigree, like truly heritage level vintage grower who's been down every frigging rabbit hole and path, including now over watering, the most simple mistake of all, you know, is that they barely use anything and
yes,
they just
true.
Get the most amazing results. And so, you know what? He'd be right there with or without my tea. I mean, come on.
That's
this
true.
Guy is just keeping it real, you know,
so
growing
TD,
soil.
TD's been building his soil for years now, and which is why he's able to, you know, to treat his plants in this way. But if you have some new soil, you perhaps need to amend it.
And your more boxes above ground,
sure.
and he's these holes in the ground. I mean, this isn't really a comparison of any kind. I mean, that's why I scoffed at John. When John's like, we're going to build this as a competition. I'm like, well, we all know who the winner of that would be. Especially with your male audience, you know, there's no... No, and for him, this is such a sport, and I've told him, you're like I am with my titanium bikes. You know, my obsession with cycling is my bike has to be more durable and enable me to ride further and experience nature on my two-wheeled pleasure, where I finally do shut up, you know, in a wife-friendly way that gives me, you know, your wife's approving your water budget this year, right?
You saw the bill.
Yeah, so my
I
bike...
I showed him the bill. Is it like 18,000 gallons?
Dude, yeah, we got
it
in a video, right?
Yeah, so I think, if I recall correctly, it was like 18,000 gallons per month last year, and then this year it's 6,000 gallons per month.
Average household month.
Exactly, and so, you know, you can obviously...
10,000 less.
But he's got holes in the ground.
Better growth.
Yeah.
He's got holes in, but he has done even more, like, flirting with disaster, dry farming, when his automatic thing, when he's gone in the desert, when it breaks, and he comes, he's like, oh, Josh, can you check on me? And he knows his friend's a stoner and isn't going to get over there. And so he comes here half expecting a month later that, you know, his ashitaba is going to be dead and gone. And everything's still, you know, like, I'd say out of
soil
the two
sake,
of the lesson.
Man.
So you got two pedigrees here, and a guy who's still talking top dressings a bit here. And a guy who sells top dressings, because I have to sell my audience what they ask for, you know, which is everyone's still wrapped up in that BS of NPK values.
Yeah.
NPK value matters, for the record.
I don't know, not if you got it set up right, man. Like,
no.
The bacteria and the microbes make the NPK
exactly.
from the organic matter if you have the right feedstock.
It's the whole, so Seth's arguing
NPK
matters in the web of life.
Exactly.
In feeding the soil.
Agreed.
Now, not to
But do we need to do a hands-on thing and screw with it?
No, we can be
So, like, let's talk about the next question then. What do you feed before flower? I mean, dude, that's a standard thing in cannabis growing. You got to put nutrients before the flower, man.
Not to answer for him, but he's going to say I don't.
Well, let's find out.
I don't.
Yeah, TD doesn't.
I'm not going to, and I never have. I used to
banana peels, man. You use
I used the banana peels.
Is that
yeah.
a feed, or is that just more of an elixir, though?
No, that's still potassium.
Okay.
It's still.
Yeah.
Are you going to do that? This is so you
So this year he's not going to show he's improving.
Well, I don't
maybe
know.
Not.
Maybe
we'll see
not.
What the yield is.
Exactly.
He's
going to
he's experimenting.
Exactly. I was just going to say this is the
So maybe you don't need to do it. Maybe
but
you
maybe
do.
You
Depends
do.
On your soil though.
Maybe do it.
Everybody's really. Different, so maybe. You shouldn't just I'm going to do exactly You don't have this soil unless you get his house one
Didn't
day.
I call it there's AI artificial intelligence as TDI. You've got TD's intelligence. He'll tell you at the end of this year whether banana peels work or not.
Oh, they do. The banana peels work. I've used that a lot.
But now you just want to flirt
this
with
year I just
even less is
just
more.
Total,
you're just loving how you're having
I believe everything's in there because I read up on some of the products that I did put in there, and they do have the calcium and potassium and stuff in them already. And I did put potassium in there once a month, dry potassium, up until this month. And so... I just sprinkle that
so
on
there's
top.
There's some key background factors, some long-term digestion.
Remember I asked you couldn't even see it. I said, remember last time you were here? Because I do it that light.
Mm-hmm.
But I did put the potassium.
Some langbeinite in there. Yeah. Mm. That's what the white crystals. So
yep.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sorry, I keep interrupting. I've been instructed not to.
How I get it to water in is that's why I use the tea on top of the soil.
To digest it.
To spray it.
To break it, to help it all break down. But I keep interrupting, and your thing on what's your answer to John, 3 minutes later, Josh, on what the top tip for pre-flowering or right at onset of flowering.
Yeah, well, we're about to see a video, or we're about to go do that at my house, but the basic idea is I like to take worm castings that have been well composted, you know, just like, you know, excellent worm castings, plus a little bit of like flower, what is that, bloom something or other. What's that? What's it called?
The rainbow mix?
Yeah, rainbow mix. Yeah, but
it's not meeting Steve Catwell's standards.
That's true.
I wanted you to substitute vegan mix and brewer's yeast, which is also free to
use.
Yeah,
so Josh hooked me up with some of the last of his flower bloom mix, so I'm just going to use all that this year and then moving forward.
Which is vegan.
Yeah.
Oh, no, rainbow. No. You're recycling the old rainbow.
So I've got some old rainbow mix that is like made for flowering, and I'm going to use the rest of that this year, and then moving forward, I'm going to go no slaughterhouse byproducts, no nothing like that. But
would you be down to earth vegan mix? Yeah. Sorry to interrupt, with brewer's yeast. Yeah. Like you and I came up with. Totally. This guy's doing a lot of R&D for Boogie. You're testing the CBC. This guy keeps instructing us to release a vermichow. The more we know, the more we don't know. Help us figure out what worms really want and what should be a supplemental superfood rather than just a chow that everyone should make in their backyards.
The other thing I do going into flower is I like a little bit of molasses or a little bit of sugar in the water. And that'll just, you know, get those microbes to go crazy and continue to break all that stuff down.
Milk.
Yeah, milk is great too.
No milk for you this year and no sugars?
My farmer quit. He's retired.
Oh, you don't have the raw milk hookup.
He's 74 years old. He finally retired.
Amazing.
Yeah, I didn't use milk all year this year. That's a first.
That's why it's doing so good.
We like the sugars. No, it was overwatering. Guaranteed. I know where I went wrong.
What an amazing, elementally basic mistake. In the presence of a master of an obsessive compulsive cannabis growing disordered
You just can't imagine what's going on below the soil, you know, until you know what's going on. Until I was told, I really didn't. When I pulled that bark back and I saw what he was talking about, I went, oh shit. I was like, good God. There's a lot of water.
Check your soil. Maybe you don't need to water, depending on, you know, also look at your plants, right? Don't just, there could be water, but your plants still might be stressing out for whatever reason. I don't know.
Overall, have your plants done better, John, when you've taught them to run dry?
Absolutely. It's never better to overwater.
Even in a dry climate to begin with, where you could argue that...
They got deep roots.
But no matter what, in that climate, no matter how much it'd be pretty hard to overwater where your full-time garden is.
Yeah, I mean, in the desert, if I don't water in the day...
You're done.
Because things dry out so fast. So they're transpiring, like... Are we just going to drink water one time for the whole month?
No.
We're going to dehydrate. Like, especially in the heat, man, we got to keep drinking water throughout the day. So I got to give my plants small bursts of water right throughout the day just so they could, like, transpire like we sweat. But then also, too, in the off season when it's not super hot, I want to water deep and less so they form deep roots so that they could handle the heat more.
You're feeding the root water system. But if you were growing Afghan water pumps, like Humboldt Seed Company's finest, you know, du jour, you know, Afghan...
I'd probably water a lot less because they're desert-adapted plants. I'm growing non-desert-adapted... I'm growing tropical plants that expect a lot of water in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not exactly the right, you know, thing to do to have dry farming.
And I learned long ago that when you teach a plant to run dry and then rehydrate it, it's when that cycle of drying out and rehydrating, you get just this wonderful explosion
of
microbes.
My
really
basil
microbes.
Does great, even like the cactuses, man, I could, you know, they do great. I could go without watering them for a little bit because they're used to it. Some plants are used to it.
Mm-hmm.
Cannabis is used to it. Right, so some plants are not.
Right. Some plants you absolutely have to water.
Right.
This is about cannabis and holes in the ground cannabis.
All right, so next question for you guys is, what's your favorite strains to grow that have been productive for you or you like for whatever reason?
My favorite plant of all time is Incredible Bulk.
Yeah.
Incredible Bulk is an amazing plant. That thing, there's not one of them that won't grow big for you, guaranteed. We had that one problem that one year where the bugs got it, but that's different when a pinch of bug gets in there. The plant itself is huge. It says right in it, it's by Dr. Crippling, who is the seed breeder of that one. And it says right in it, if you're going to grow indoor, to make sure that you switch it to flower before it hits 2 feet. Before 2 feet.
Good God.
Otherwise, it could take over the room. And it also says can grow up to 20 regular marijuana plants.
And we have footage. Oh yeah, TD Vault on the Boogie Brew YouTube channel.
That plant was amazing.
TD. He just recently gave us some, you know, some low resolution, but it's insane.
It was. I told you before in the videos, even my mom wanted a picture in front of that thing. And you can tell why.
Yeah.
But she's a Christian.
The lemongrass might be approaching her level.
They're both in competition with it. Actually, these three up front are.
With your top ever.
Yep.
Right there.
They're right there with it, yep. Guaranteed.
And you, Seth?
Yeah, so my favorite genetics to grow are usually something that's crossed with something that has a lot of CBD or CBN in it. And so I think there is kind of a race to the bottom in the cannabis industry right now to just focus on THC percentage at the expense of a lot of other things. And so I like to take, like, I like when a breeder will take a THC dominant variety and a CBD dominant variety and cross them so that you get a lot of the benefit of the CBD, but then you're not growing just a CBD plant, because the CBD plants, let's be honest, are totally boring. I like at least a little bit of THC, somewhere in the teens as far as percentage goes, I think is perfect. And so, like, right now I'm growing something called peyote Skittles, which is a cross of Skittles and peyote Wi-Fi. Peyote Wi-Fi is a full CBD strain,
yeah,
and then Skittles is a great strain. And so,
what are the percentages?
I'm not sure. I mean, I don't know. I could look it up, but who knows if those percentages are even accurate based on how you grow it. But what I will say is that when you take a CBD strain and a THC strain and you mix them, not only do you get a little bit of hybrid vigor, but you also get like a very unique terpene profile, because it's not tasting like just those crazy THC plants. There's like the CBN, the CBD, and all the other crazy terpenes that are in there, and you're getting like a more unique smoke, something that's harder to find at a club.
And what's his name? MIT told us years ago in one of your videos that cancer cells will not commit suicide without you for CBD being therapeutic on like a Rick Simpson oil. It will not work without the presence of THC.
Oh, another good genetic.
You have to have some THC in there if you have cancer cells and you want them to commit suicide.
Another good genetic that matches this description, where it's like a high CBD and high THC, is Sour Tsunami, which I grew a lot of last year. That turned out great. You remember that shit.
Do I?
Yeah, dude.
Been so good, I don't even remember.
No, we smoked a ton of that. Smoked so much of that shit.
This is the place. Like, we're sitting right here in the Josh Tranquilizer Dart, like, corner. Oh, my goodness.
What else is going on?
All right, so the next question for both you guys is, what has been your most productive harvest, like, per plant? Like, how many pounds per plant have you got most
incredible
ever?
It has to be incredible goal.
Per plant was that year. It was that year, yeah. I averaged like 11 per plant. So
God, dude.
We have the footage.
No, I know.
I had almost 60 pounds.
And so what was the top plant like? How much did the top plant produce? You said 11 pounds on average, but what, like, the top plant was 13?
It was 14.6, right?
14.6.
Here, I mean, the climate is not the best here for that. There's a lot of fog here.
Yeah, it was 14.
It could have been 16 or 17 in South Humboldt.
Dried product.
Dried and trimmed on the table.
Dried and
trimmed. In video.
And we have it. Yeah.
All right, well, I don't even know if me following up on that is worthwhile, because the most I've ever grown in a year total is about 3 pounds. And that's across all my plants combined. And so my plants are just not bulking up the same way TD's are. He's got a totally different setup, and he's going for yield, and he's killing it. My plants, you know, because I'm interplanting them, and because I'm in smaller beds of soil than TD is, the most I've ever gotten out of a plant is probably like a pound and a half.
Which is awesome. That's better than I ever did outdoors.
A pound and a half would last most people a lifetime.
In a permaculture food forest, you know, in a whole different setting, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean,
so it's usually plenty, and what I like to do is just share it. You know, it's great. Show up someplace with a couple of pre-rolls, maybe some jars, and then by the time you leave, they're all given out to people that appreciate it. I think that's a lot of fun.
You can't remember which strain yielded you the most?
It was Hindu Hammer. Hindu Kush and 9-pound Hammer gave me a pound and a half on one of the plants.
Which is very respectable.
Delicious, too.
I mean, come on, wouldn't you be happy even, even though you just
that's
use
so
it?
Much,
I mean,
man.
Who would actually benefit the most from these huge plants? There's no way TD can consume that medicine he gives it away. Believe me, I've been a lucky recipient. But I mean, John, with eating it and juicing
it, you can eat it a lot faster than you can
maybe
smoke
John
it.
Should be
I'll,
like.
I'll take you up on that.
So when the end product is eaten and juiced, then you could make the argument that guys like John need to grow these trees too, not just people who are doing it for literally a sport. I mean, for this guy, it's a sport. I mean, nothing that's ever worth doing in life is ever easy. Let me look at this guy's channel. Who does that?
1,400
who does
videos
that?
Later, right?
Yeah, I mean, who does that? This guy does that.
Next question is, how do you guys harvest, dry, and cure your plants?
Well, when I start, I just cut the Y's out of the plant, the big sticks, hang those on my net in the garage, which is got a dehumidifier in there at 55 to 60. And it also has one fan going in there, so there's consistent air all the time. I have a dry curtain, so there's no hair from the dogs that go in there. And then I let them dry for like 10 days. And then if the stem pops, then I'll cut the buds off and put them into a fiber barrel and run that fiber barrel for like 7 days, open it and close it in the morning and at night, and to burp it. And then after that, I hand trim it.
What's a fiber barrel?
So it's cardboard barrels.
Oh. It's like a big 55-gallon
drum. We showed it in the video.
You did a whole video, right?
Yeah, yeah. Link down below for the whole series with TDs. You can see his whole process.
Yeah. My answer to that question is when I first cut them, I try to keep them in as large of clusters as possible. You know, like I'll go low on the plant and try to get maybe even the whole plant if I'm lucky. You know, you just like chop it at the very bottom and then flip it upside down. I let it dry in my garage or like wherever I've got room. And so what I do is I like to do 60 degrees, 60% humidity for 16 days. It's super easy. It's 60, 60, 16. So you monitor your humidity 60%. You do, if you can control the temperature, you want about 60 degrees. And then you can do that for 16 days. Usually that gets you to where you need to be. And then usually by the time I'm done drying, I don't do the burping and curing process. I like to just cap them and just like, well, leave them in their container. If they've been dried properly, a lot of the time they won't need to be burped and cured like that. They'll cure themselves inside the container if they have the right amount of moisture.
I haven't had the privilege of trying the aged version of what you described, but I know what he does is right because we've both been recipients of two-year-old GG number four. So it's not what we do, it's how we go about doing it. And if you do it the way these guys are doing it, I love those stoner-proof numbers. Nice. Yeah.
Right?
60, 60, 16.
Yeah, that's from Build a Soil. They taught me that.
Yeah, and so there you go. Awesome. The tips are out there.
All right, so the last question I have for everybody, including our peanut gallery Josh over there, is what final words of wisdom would you like to share with growers that are watching this video today?
Well, can I
keep
right?
Keep growing.
Okay. keep on growing. There you go. It's your best words, but if I can cut in on you, Seth, look.
Sure.
Grow soil. Grow soil, not plants. Follow Super Steve C. Follow Stephen Campbell's advice.
Yeah.
You're gonna go visit that guy. I'm really curious how he's doing this year with both his amazing cannabis farm and the vegetable farm that he operates in this insane global crisis, this heat event. I mean, he's right there near you.
Is he outdoor? Because I was just at an outdoor farm in Perum.
He's living soil, which is, I mean, it's the way these guys
indoor.
Grow.
Indoor, yes.
Yeah. Indoor living soil.
Oh, he's indoor. I apologize. Yes. That's right. He isn't there some good ones. So.
Yeah. And apparently Steve Cantwell and Green Life Productions just had their 100th harvest.
And they're gonna
doing it all out of living soil. He's just flipping these beds.
Grow soil.
That's awesome.
And watch the episode that seems impossible to download and watch. But, you know, go visit him. Get him on front of the GYG audience.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I got comments in the video I've done in the episode. Thank you for editing my... wasn't that a good interview I did with Super Steve C?
It was excellent. Yeah.
And my tip is just follow Super Steve C and what you do. Like, I mean, all of it. And what you do and what he does. Like, it grow soil. That's my tip. And go watch Super Steve C and what he has to say. Steve Cantwell, former UFC fighter champion. And
I don't think he was a champion. Was he?
It doesn't matter.
That'd be
he's
crazy.
A, he's
he was a champion.
He was a full blown, like, he's Steve freaking Cantwell. But I'm just saying, like, the comment I got was, because Boogie Brew channel is small, so I still read the comments. So you read all your comments. But the comment I got was, John needs to go visit him, really show what's going on. He's the only guy that's growing real what they were talking about, terpenes, you know, not like, do you give a shit about THC content or do you give a shit about terpenes?
I want both, actually.
There you go. Well, you are, that's the sports. You're like, you know what, why not break that effing record while I'm at it? But I'd still rate you as a Boogie bro who does care about flavor. If it was like some garbage flavor that was 32% and was guaranteed to make your friend Josh go, you know, utterly comatose in this chair, but it didn't taste worth a damn, you probably wouldn't want to grow it again, right? So what, you know, if you're going to rate them, 51% taste, 49% importance of taste. And what you certainly would, right? I mean, that's what you were
absolutely,
just...
Absolutely, yeah.
So,
but also, like, it's an entourage, and so you want that THC, you want that CBD, you want all these other terpenes and all this other amazing stuff that's in this plant, but I think where people go wrong is they just focus on THC.
Oh, they're worshipping a THC.
Exactly. You're worshipping a percentage of a plant.
You're missing out on so much.
Yeah, exactly. And you're really not prioritizing what people actually care, what people actually should care about, which is how it tastes, how it makes you feel, blah, blah, blah.
How strong is VCP? Vanilla cream pie.
She can get up to 25%.
Okay, I sat there and went pretty comatose on her. What about blueberry muffin?
I think that's only supposed to be 22%.
And what did I tell you?
But all the rest are 30%.
Man, what did I tell you about blueberry muff? I said she's balanced.
Yep.
She balances me.
Yep.
The boogie boy, you know, weed is my speed, you know, yep. It was the most smoothest balance on me. I want to visit that pastry.
It was so funny. You're like,
I want to visit that pastry shop again. Yeah. Isn't that weird that I described it that way, and then you tell me HSC has it like listed just that way?
That's how they do it, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
That was too funny when you said that I about died laughing.
So, yeah.
Like, no way.
and again, you know, going back to this whole episode, which is dry farming is king, less is more. You're not going to hit those max terpene levels if you're sitting there following some Dedrian company's regime and overwatering at the same time. And
well, you're killing part of the plant.
You're killing so much. And the Afghani water pumps are like, we want to run dry. We want to get those
vanilla
sticky
cream
flowers.
Pie from last year. Remember when we pulled it? That one part was dead. That has to be from overwatering.
Exactly.
Mm. Has to be.
Amazing that a master committed such an elemental mistake. Amazing that we all, the more we know, the more we don't know. And he's just out there giving them the vitamin L.
That's the easiest one, the water.
Yeah.
The easiest just one, and you were wildly, thank goodness we had a drought. You know, thank goodness your soil, because imagine if you were overwatering now.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's what I mean. What did we do? What did it say? 10, right?
It was like 9 or 10. It doesn't matter where you put the probe, it's all 9 or 10.
Yeah. And imagine if you were just like doing your normal routine and watering.
So all right, Seth, so what's your tip?
Yeah, so my tip is context. So it's like everything about your garden depends on your weather. It depends on the terroir of your soil. It depends on what you planted last year and what pests you are expecting. And so you have to pay attention to your own context. Like, I would not be able to dry farm because my house is all on sandy fill and it, you know, the water just falls right through like a sieve or something. And so, you know, like, while I'm very jealous of TD's amazing setup, you know, I could not emulate that in my context. And so, you know, it's like context matters so much. That's one of the things that Gabe Brown talks about, who's one of my favorite soil guys. He's like context is so key. Like, it matters more than anything, right? Like, mm-hmm. you have to be in the right context to do the right farming methods.
Mm-hmm. So, cool. Yeah, I mean, it is really an apples and oranges comparison.
It is.
Plus, totally he's on this moist hillside, this wonderful aqua pump.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, so, a little bit of a riverbed down
all
here.
All the way around me.
But yeah, totally. Certainly the hole's in the ground and you know, but there's two different ways to skin a cat.
Exactly. So yeah, not any one way is right. You got to find the right way that works for you. And actually that's what my tip is for you guys today is I want you guys to never stop experimenting, right? TD could have been on his high horse. I know it all. I'm going to do it the way I do. And then he threw a curveball because he got so much rain this winter. Yeah. And now he's just like, oh, let's just dry farm this stuff. Dude, it's kicking some butt. So, like, if you think you know it all, you probably don't, unless you're God. Yeah, God knows it all. But, you know, and so just, like, let nature humor us. And the other thing I'd say is that I want you guys to always observe nature and how it works and try to emulate nature, right?
The more we know, the more we...
The more we don't know. And so, like, you have to just also never stop learning. Don't stop experimenting. Yeah, you know. Your irrigation cuts off in the on position like it has for me. That's a good experiment. Cost me a lot of money one time. But, you know, I saw what happened, and then I saw when I cut water back too much. So once again, you want to get it just right, and depending on your soil, balance. if you check your moisture level right, it's already moist. Yeah, you don't need to water it, man, and then observe your plants and to verify that they're looking healthy and they're not wilting out, even though your soil meter says there's water. Maybe it's your soil meter needs to go deeper because the roots are deeper. You know, TD is measuring the soil at the top where it's the driest, whereas down below it's even more wet. It could even be standing water.
A lake.
Down there could be a lake that we don't know, because they got to get some soil meters that are like 5 feet deep, man.
He's scared of what he'll find.
A bigger rectal scale, too.
Yeah, right. So, yeah, that's my final tip for you guys.
I mean, John, I thought when I started Boogie Brew, I knew everything about compost tea. And guess what? Every day I learn from your own viewers, from my customers, you know.
Never stop learning, man.
I mean, I never knew about seed sprout teas. I barely knew K&F, you know. I barely knew a lot of shit. And banana peels, and so...
The banana peels works really, really well.
There's so much stuff.
I throw a ton of banana peels in my compost.
Well, yeah, in the compost, okay, you got the same thing going. But totally. You can do a banana peel tea.
That's fucking sick.
And you only do it for the whole week, you know. You eat one banana, you throw it in the water, one banana, distilled water.
You stay regular that week.
Yeah, and I have a jar that's like this that I make it in.
Right.
And then I transfer it to a 5 gallon bucket.
Okay.
But then after the seventh day, that's when you harvest it, you pour it in the 5 gallon bucket, and then you put it in a cool spot, and you'll be fine.
Add that to the notes. You got it right here.
Love it, man.
If you do it to one of your plants next year, you'll find out how hard the nuts get.
That's
nuts. It's amazing.
I'm going to do it this year, man.
But they're too big right now to do that much tea. You know what
I mean?
God.
Be careful what you wish for.
Exactly. That's been a fun
Even TD has his limits.
All right, so the final thing I'd like to say is if you guys want to learn more about TD's grow this year, you want to check out Josh's channel. Josh, what is your channel there?
I don't even know the name. Tell them. Boogie Brew.
Just search Boogie Brew on YouTube.
And that'll get you to Josh's channel, where he's been filming regular updates at TD's place since I'm not doing anymore. So you guys could continue to learn what TD's growing, how his grow is progressing over the season. Definitely recommend you guys check out Josh's channel. And more importantly, subscribe to his channel. Get him some view, guys. He actually does read the comments, unlike me, and he didn't even reply.
I'm still insecure.
Show Boogie Brew some love on YouTube.
I mean, all those Soil Life Summit episodes were good. Thank you, man.
You did a good job.
Some good stuff, and I always say money's like manure. You got to spread it around in the right places, and certainly the knowledge. Certainly, we should almost, in the light of this conversation, I want to call this this is the FBF episode, the field-based farmer episode. Mm. And that's what FBFing is, you know? And I think kind of the focus, as I work with Seth, this awesome video editor, couldn't get these videos on the Boogie Brew channel without this gentleman's assistance. We got to keep focusing on that, because that's what all of this is. That's what all of you are. Your viewers, it's a field-based system. And do you feel me, baby? This is the only future we've got. This is the only future humanity's got. None of these fools need to go and get their feelings met on some cruise ship they don't need. They can take a vacation in their own medical and food forest backyards. And that's the future of humanity, being a field-based society, a society that reconnects with this planet, that gets out of our mechanized industrial world consciousness. And thank you, John, I've been saying it for years, that's the real message, not my little sexy compost tea product I sell on the sidelines to, a commercial conduit to you all, a movement, the GYG movement, which is the great simplification and growing soil. Yeah. Growing soil. And thank you for 14. You need another 1,400 episodes. If we can help it, if we can help it,
another 15 years.
Do you understand? Do you understand? Are you starting to understand? Because I watched your episode you did the other day on how to beat the heat and so on. Do you understand how severe things are? Of course you do.
Yes, yeah, getting
worse. And do you understand how important your movement is? I mean, I have a sister who's a lawyer who's now I sold my property, I'm watching John Cola videos, I'm GYGing my new patch that I bought. Do you understand? People are realizing that. They're getting that. That these are the passions we should cultivate rather than selfish, just amusing ourselves syndromes. Nothing that's ever worth doing in life is ever easy. I said that about your own channel. I'll say that about your garden we went to. And this gentleman clearly demonstrates that. So, you know, keep at it. Keep working really hard to be those FBFers, field-based farmers. And thank you, John, for giving us all a voice in a community and a message. You're the leader, dude. You are a patriarch. You have no important.
I just make a YouTube channel and
not to blow more smoke up your amazing overproductive ass, but listen, bro, the next 1,400 videos you do are more important still than the last, right? Were truer words ever spoken?
I dig it.
Do I talk a lot, but do I ever talk poop?
Not in my experience.
Exactly. Thank you. All right. Last.
All right. So, anyways, if you guys enjoy this episode doing the head-to-head TD versus Super Seth,
Who's the goal
for me was to share with you guys the two different methods of growing, and also hopefully sharing with you guys some knowledge and information that you guys could utilize yourself. No matter where you are in your journey, I want you guys to take a step forward instead of taking steps back by using Dendrians and other products, because I know there's some of you guys that are watching me out there that still use them,
which are making them oil and gas
off them. Yeah. So
anyway, oil and gas.
If you guys enjoy this episode, hey, big thumbs this up. More importantly, share this video with other people so that they can learn about some of the best growing techniques, living soil growing techniques out there on YouTube today. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes of coming every 5 to 7 days, even when I don't show up. Or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel, make sure you click the bell so you get notified of as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check out past episodes of Our Wealth of Knowledge. We'll put all the links to TD's 2 years of growing down below, as well as the episodes I've done at Super Seth's place as well, so you guys can glean even more knowledge from these two amazing farmer/gardeners.
And thank you for doing this, John. Thank you for coming in. Thank you so much.
No worries. I got to get running. I got to get back to my garden. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.
Woo!